places, but have the same name. Cause we were born for this. We were born for this. Alrighty, we're a little late, but we are live. Today we're going to be talking about soft talk and how it affects our mindset and our actions. So we're going to have Bethany kind of kick this off. She is currently going through a mindset coaching program, and soft talk is a big part of that and how we communicate with ourselves. So we want to try to help you guys recognize it and then how to make small adjustments to help with our mindset, help with our actions so we can move towards our goals and just be kind of happier overall, right? So
yes.
What is soft talk? We'll start with that.
Soft talk are words or phrases that undercut or soften our language. It makes us sound less confident or less committed. That's what it protects us from, is the commitment. And examples of this would be words like maybe, hopefully, I think, I'll try, sort of, kind of, probably, potentially, possible, perhaps, probably, all the things. So when we use those types of words, it creates mental and verbal loopholes that allow us to back out of commitments or to downplay our intentions. And by becoming more aware of it, we can shift our language towards something that's more empowering, more decisive. Some common examples, especially with fitness and health, is I'll try to make it to the gym. And it suggests that there's a chance that they won't. Mm-hmm. So if they don't make it to the gym, they didn't break a promise.
Right.
They said, well, I was going to try to, but
yeah,
I did this instead. Maybe I'll start meal prepping next week. Sounds less like a plan and more like a hope. And I think I can stick to this plan. It lacks commitment and confidence. And these phrases might sound harmless, or they'll sound very common that many people use these, but they weaken your resolve and they create a subconscious resistance to follow through. And way more likely to back out on whatever you're aiming to do more of or aiming to implement.
Mm-hmm.
So ways that you can spot this, you want to actively listen, or you can just start to notice it in other things too.
Pay attention to other people when they use it.
So we can talk about what we've started doing
mm-hmm.
now that I've brought the attention to mm-hmm. soft talk from learning in the certification more about it. And noticing it myself, and then teaching you guys about it. What have you guys noticed?
Yeah. So you had us do an exercise where we wrote down like a, I don't even remember what I wrote.
I think it was I could.
That was I should.
Or I should X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
I should work out today. I should do the dishes today. I should clean the house today.
So anyways, after Bethany had us do that exercise, I noticed myself, even just talking to myself at home, like literally just not even saying anything out loud, but in my head thinking things like, I should vacuum today, I should do a load of laundry, I should shower and wash my hair, which is like a chore for me. Not everyone will understand that, but I started to catch myself saying those things. And you're right, like when I say I should vacuum the floors, I probably I'm going to not do it. I'm probably going to be like, well, I don't really have to, though, because I said that I just should. I didn't say that I have to. But I've started, not every time, but I've started to catch myself when I say those things. And instead, I say, I am going to vacuum the floors. I need to vacuum the floors. I have to vacuum the floors. I'm going to do it right now and just get it over with. And then another thing that I've personally done, and I think I said this last time, is telling myself, like, my future self will thank me if I do this right now, because otherwise it gets put off and I need to do it another day. Or even like when it comes to working out, it, like you said, like I'll try to get to the gym today. Okay, I don't get there today. I'll try to get there tomorrow. Okay, I don't get there tomorrow. Then when are you going to get there? Or instead saying, I'm going to make it to the gym Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and setting those goals, setting those just like set in stone dates, knowing exactly what time you're going to get to the gym, then you're way more likely to get there than just saying, I'll try. I don't know what time I'm going to try, but I'll just try.
Yeah.
Where instead, I'm going to come to Fit Camp at 6:15 a.m. Mm-hmm. tomorrow morning. Mm-hmm. Yep. And then it's going to happen.
Yeah. Okay. What have you noticed, Laura?
For me, I don't use it. I don't think I use it as much in...
Oh.
Oh, there you go.
There you go. Thank
you. All right. I don't use it as much in talking to myself as I do with talking to other people, having a conversation mm-hmm. with another person. Like, I notice it more in that way, and it's when I want to try, and I do it unintentionally and not consciously, but it's I want to try and sound more agreeable with them.
Mm-hmm. So you want to sound more agreeable with them, not try
you
to?
You just use it again.
Yeah. See, I'm doing it
right I know, just resonating. Yeah. But you see how
yeah.
you don't even notice
yeah.
if you're using it?
Yeah. Or avoid conflict.
Right.
So I think that's... I did it. I did it mm-hmm. again. I can't even finish a whole
so
sentence.
So, like, when you talk to somebody, you tell them, well, you should try this, or
yeah.
you should maybe think about this.
Yeah.
Instead of, like, being more...
Coming across.
Assertive.
Yeah.
You also don't want to just tell somebody to do something,
right.
because then they're not going to want to do it.
Right.
Right. Or if somebody asked me... Hey, like, will you take the trash out later? It's like, yeah, I could probably do that. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yep. You can say that.
Like, I'm not
I could
that.
Probably do that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a board that I use a lot. So, but yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not just like with yourself, but it can also be used to, like I said,
when
avoid conflict. Yeah. Or sound agreeable.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
How about you, Taylor? How have you noticed that? You catch yourself
well,
a lot
yeah,
more.
I've caught myself quite a few times. Even just in our meeting, I've caught myself saying probably or things like that.
Hopefully,
yep. So I've caught myself doing that. And I think, I mean, it'll help me personally, obviously, be more committed and more motivated and kind of like what you were saying with certain things that I want to do instead of saying, oh, you know, I hopefully can do that. I'm going to try to do that. I'll probably do that. I should do that. It's no, I can do that. And it's and when you say I can do that, then it's kind of opens your mind up. Okay, how am I going to do this?
Right.
What kind of plan of action do I need to take? And let's come up with that plan of action. So it's just shifting that mindset to believing that you can. There was a great kind of story. Jeff, the guy that actually introduced me to the mindset coaching program that you're doing, he was having a conversation with one of his clients, and they started the exercise saying, I need to, I think it was I need to or I have to, and she said that I have to go home and clean my pool, and she was super not looking forward to it. She, you know, was dreading it, and she was, you know, it stressed her out, things like that, and he said, have you ever thought about you get to clean your pool? Like, because you have a pool. Like, a lot of people don't have a pool.
Mm-hmm.
And she literally, like, started crying because she was switched her frame of mind to, like, having to do this task to I'm super grateful that I actually have a pool that I can go and enjoy every
mm-hmm.
single day.
Mm-hmm.
And so just recognizing those words and then reshifting it can completely change your outlook on
mm-hmm.
life in general.
Mm-hmm.
But especially attaching it to, like, health and fitness. Because we hear so many times, like, where people will be like, I'm going to try to go to the gym. You know, I'll probably start to meal prep, or I think I'm going to eat better, you know, that kind of stuff.
Try to eat better,
all those kinds of things. But like you said, not only does it, you're not very confident and you're not as likely to follow through with it, but you're also subconsciously like building that up in your mind where all of a sudden everything in life becomes a try, probably have to, need to, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. The have to and need to, which you mentioned earlier,
mm-hmm.
I caught that.
Yeah.
Saying instead of I should do this, you're saying, oh, I have to do this, I need to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Even though maybe it did get you to do it, maybe you did put it off.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened. I don't know what you did. But those phrases are a different type of language than soft talk.
Yeah.
It's more of a pressure language or a negative language.
Sometimes that's what I need, though.
Yeah, so pressure language.
But if you we'll go ahead and finish it
yeah.
now.
So pressure language creates it as it's when you say, I have to do this, you feel forced.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're not enjoying it. You're not grateful to be doing it. It's stressful. It's adding more stress. But if you say, I can vacuum the floors.
Or I get to.
Because, mm-hmm. or I get to. Or, yeah, you can reframe it as I get to because, and then put a reason that you get to because not everybody is able to do that or something mm-hmm. like that. And if you say, I can clean my pool this afternoon because I have 30 minutes to do that after work.
Yeah.
And so breaking it down, then making it action-oriented, which you touched on, of making it from soft to solid talk, making a solid talk, you're now switching your mind from just vague and ambiguous things. Oh, I think I can do, or maybe I should do this, or I'll probably do that or get to that. You're putting your mind on, I will do this. It's like, okay, how am I going to do that? So now you're action focused and you're figuring out ways to do it. And so now you're going to actually follow through on that, or you're more likely to follow through on that. Mm-hmm. What was you going to say?
That, I think that was it. Oh, I was just going to say, okay. Like, switching from I need to or I have to I get mm-hmm. to do this, gotcha. Or I can do this because I have the ability, I have the time, I have the home, mm-hmm. whatever, like, reframing that mind, yeah. I think can be really powerful.
Yeah. Right. And getting a little bit to the reason that we use soft talk is, we have talked about it a little bit, is the fear of commitment. Committing fully can be very intimidating.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And people may want to keep their options open or to avoid failure.
Mm-hmm.
And it keeps them safe. It's also avoidance of disappointment. If you use softer language, it can feel safer, especially if they struggled with sticking to fitness goals or health goals before. It makes them feel safer, safe from failing, but they're also less likely to ever succeed
mm-hmm.
if they don't use it. And also self-doubt. That's another trademark of soft talk, mostly reflects underlying doubts about your ability to succeed, which that can come from maybe endeavors in the past that haven't worked out. You have tried to change your eating and things like that in the past, and so now you use soft talk to, okay, well, if I fail again and I say that I was going to do this, then I'm going to fail or I'll be a failure. And so starting to reframe and empower and use supportive language will help to boost you towards that goal mm-hmm. and be way more likely to succeed with that.
That's good.
Anything else on soft talk before we dive into turning it into solid talk? You know, you had some things that you looked up.
I just want to touch on, so like when you mentioned protecting yourself from failure, I think that's a huge reason why people use soft talk. I try, probably, I should, I think, whatever. I look at, even if you did commit and you did say, I can do this, and you didn't follow through, I would rather fail trying than hope that I ever do it and not actually even start.
Yeah.
Because I look at every failure as a lesson. So you want to break that down. Okay, why did I fail? What do I need to do next time to where I'm more successful? And every obstacle that you run into is an opportunity. Okay, how can I have the opportunity now to make some changes to where I can do this, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think for people that use this soft talk and are afraid of failure, you should really think about all these failures, even if you did fail. You know, if you said, hey, I'm going to work out 3 days a week and you only made it one day a week and you think you failed, it's okay, I made it one day a week. You could look at the positives for one, mm-hmm. but then it's okay, what do I need to do to get 2 days a week? What do I need to do to get 3 days a week? It's just an opportunity and a lesson learned to become better
mm-hmm.
because nobody ever succeeds without hitting those roadblocks and having those little failures where they have to relook at their plan, strategize, become a different person, where they can elevate and get past that level that they're
mm-hmm.
at. I've failed so many different times and many different things, but I've also realized recently, actually, that I do have limiting beliefs still, and I still am afraid of failure, especially when it comes to the business and stuff like that. But if I want to get to where I want to be with our goals and where we're headed with our mission, I have to take chances. And all I'm going to do is learn from any failures that I run into and get better and grow from that to get to where I want to be.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And that is a really good mindset to focus on of, okay, if you do fail, doesn't mean that you're a failure.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You have opportunities to learn from these things. You can celebrate the positives. There's all these different ways to go about it, which that does also tie into the mindset shift outside of just losing soft talk as well. So greater mindset shift, because not everybody's going to have that mindset if they do plan to make it to the gym 3 days a week and only make it once. And then that does feed into it a little bit if there's more negative talk. So there's more mindset to work to do beyond that, but that's definitely a good place to start and a good thing to start thinking about and keeping in mind is if you don't reach that goal, maybe you need to set different goals.
That's what I was going to say, like making sure your goals are realistic. Like,
yes.
What am I actually capable, like challenging yourself, yes, but also being realistic with yourself.
And making sure they're clear goals too. We worked on that today of making our goals more clear for 2025 and beyond and making them more actionable. Let's see. Any other little tidbits on self-talk in general?
I don't think so.
No? Okay. So changing, how do we go from self-talk to solid talk? We're just starting to introduce changing the words that we use. The first step is being able to recognize it. The easiest way to recognize soft talk is in writing first. So if you're sending a text to somebody or an email, you'll start to notice those words in writing first. And then you'll start to hear it when you say things or when others say things to you. You'll start to hear the soft talk. And then you'll start noticing it in your own thoughts. Like Caitlin mentioned, like you start noticing in your own head when you start using soft talk. And so those are the three different stages of awareness. And how you go about changing it is you start replacing it with solid talk words. So instead of maybe, I guess, I'll try, you can put in, I will, I can, I am, I know, I can commit to, certainly, definitely choose to, I'm focused on, all those different things. Or I'm pursuing. But that doesn't mean that soft talk is always bad. It's okay to use it sometimes. There's certain situations where you have to use a maybe. Like maybe we'll make it to this Christmas function because it does depend on if somebody's going to get out of work on time and they don't know that day. Yeah. And it's okay. But being intentional about when you use soft talk and not letting it plague your inner thoughts and your speech. You want to be intentional when you do use soft talk. So trading out those soft talk words for solid talk. And what we can do is to write it down, which is what we've done, what I've done for my assignment this week, is write down soft talk words. You can look them up. There's like 20 of them. There's actually, if you go on ChatGPT, 47 that it comes up with. You can print it out and you can post it somewhere with big letters so you can see it.
It's all like the half time. My vocabulary. That's like half my vocabulary.
Half your vocabulary, 47 words. Yeah. So you want to hang it somewhere that you can see it every day. Because the more you see those words, the more you'll notice them. Same thing of when you buy a new car.
Yeah, and you see
it and you start seeing it everywhere.
Yeah.
And you never noticed them before. It's not like everybody just went out and bought that new car. It's you noticed it, you became aware of it, you see it all the time. Now your brain is searching for those things. So now you're starting to search and find those soft talk words. And you start to realize how much you use that without even noticing. You might think, oh, I really don't use that much soft talk words. And then you're like, oh, I don't think I use that much soft talk words.
Like, you just used it.
And you're like, oh, I just used it. It's like, okay. So starting to become aware of it's first step. And then focusing on switching out when you catch yourself, say the sentence again, but with a solid mm-hmm. talk word. And that will help you to reframe what you say and what you write. And then that will, over time, change how you think, too.
Mm-hmm. Yep. One tip that I just thought of is maybe start kind of playing around and explaining this to a friend or a family member or your spouse, and then you can kind of catch each other or help mm-hmm. each other recognize yeah. mm-hmm. when you use it, like we just did with Lauren, and he's yeah. like, oh my gosh.
Yeah. I can't stop.
He was like,
it's like a snowball.
So, because I think that'll really help, like you might not notice when you use it, right? But
yeah.
but like if you were paying attention to somebody else, it's like, oh wow, yeah.
He was. Yeah.
But then you can kind of almost help each other recognize it and overcome and start to change the way we talk to each other in you know, when we're mm-hmm. speaking to someone. So
right. That's good.
I like that.
Yeah. Because I mean, we're kind of
doing it to
helping
each other,
each other every single
week. We are helping each other every single week.
Not did I say of. Kind of?
You yeah. did.
See?
Gotcha.
We should have some sort of punishment, like a burpee or something.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about that. But, I think that's a good wrap. So yeah. start focusing on
that's a good wrap.
The words that you use, and then start focusing on the words that you use. Work on incorporating more solid talk into your vocabulary and swapping out that soft talk.
Yeah.
Perfect. Great.
Well, great talk today, you guys. That was very helpful for a lot of people.
Yes.
Have a wonderful day and stay healthy.
Please like and subscribe.
One. Yeah. Thanks again for tuning in to the Trainer Talk. If you are ready to gain back control of your health and fitness, we would love to sit down and chat with you to see if we can put together a plan for you. All you have to do is head to taylorhutchinsonfitness.net and book a free consult. Again, make sure you like and subscribe if you like the video, and hopefully we'll see you soon.